Let's give another warm welcome to the immortal Stan Friedman, ladies and gentlemen.
My job today, I guess, is to convince you, I know you'll find it hard to believe, that the subject of flying saucers really represents a kind of cosmic Watergate. And I know the word UFOs is up there, it's shorter. And I want to make a distinction because some people complain about, I use the term flying saucer, Stan, come on. All flying saucers are UFOs. Not all UFOs are flying saucers. All great grandfathers are men. Not all men are great grandfathers. I'm interested in flying saucers. I'm not interested, generally speaking, in UFOs. I'm interested in, the, you know, when I'm building a nuclear reactor, which I haven't done in a long time, I'm interested in the isotope of uranium that's fissionable. I don't care much about the one that isn't. So I'm interested in flying saucers, intelligently controlled extraterrestrial spacecraft. This is not to say all UFOs are flying saucers. That's not what I'm saying. Okay. I'm sure you can read these, but conclusions after 56 years, it's 57 now, but that, who's counting? There's overwhelming evidence that some UFOs are intelligently controlled extraterrestrial spacecraft. Two, the subject of today's program, we're dealing with a cosmic Watergate. I hope most of you are old enough to remember Watergate, Richard Nixon government lies, first time ever that a president resigned, et cetera. Here we're dealing with a cosmic Watergate. Governments have been, I hate to use the word, but it's true, have been lying, misrepresenting, hiding the truth, call it whatever you want. There are no good arguments against those two conclusions. And basically, we're dealing with the biggest story of the millennium. I think there have only been about a dozen PhD theses done. There's room for 50. It's a big story. And there are facts and data, and I subscribe to the notion that one should have facts in hand before putting mouth in gear. I realize in today's world that's not a popular notion, but it's mine. Just a quick rundown. Largest study ever done about flying saucers for the United States Air Force. Project Blue Book Special Report 14, published way back in 1955, not distributed, but completed. Data on 3,201 sightings. It's funny how it isn't cited in almost everything that's been published, especially by the nasty, noisy negativists, as I call them when I'm being polite, the UFO debunkers. Now, I bring it up here because it illustrates the problem. Here's what the public was told in the press release that went out. On the basis of this study, this is from the Secretary of the Air Force, mind you, not some airmen wandering down the street. We believe that no objects such as those properly described as flying saucers have overflown the United States. I feel certain that even the unknown 3% could have been explained as conventional phenomena or illusions if more complete observational data had been obtained. Donald Quarles. That's very straightforward. There's really nothing to this. When we have enough data, we can explain everything. Forget it. But I had the report. This was the first page and report I found at the University of California, Berkeley. And when I look at the report, I find there's a couple of flat out lies there. There's Quarles. I don't like being lied to. Here's a breakdown of the reports. The only ones we're interested in are the unknowns, my flying saucers, if you will. 3%, it's not 3% at all. It's 21.5%. That's a long way from 3% where I went to school. interesting. Oh, you're wondering about that psychological. 1.5%. The American Physical Society, to which I and most physicists, but not Bob Lazar, belong, psychological aberrations, that is, actually, found that 2% of the physics papers that were submitted to them were crazy crackpot papers. So there are more crackpots associated with physics than with flying saucers. I'm one of the few with a foot in each camp, you understand. But you'll notice that separate category. Unlike what the secretary said, if there wasn't enough data, by definition, the case was listed as insufficient information, not unknown. Finding the facts and this false statement got me aggravated. And I was determined I'd find out more about flying saucers because I don't like being lied to, especially by somebody at the level of the Secretary of the Air Force. So I, unlike the debunkers, talk about this report all the time. Here's a quality evaluation. My University of Chicago classmate for 3 years, Carl Sagan, has been quoted several times saying that there are interesting sightings that aren't reliable. There are reliable sightings that aren't interesting, but there are no interesting and reliable sightings. Sounds good. No reference given, no fact provided, and it's false. Here's a breakdown. Of the best cases, 35% were unknowns. The poorest cases, only 18%. The ones listed as insufficient information, obviously very few of them were considered excellent. So the better the quality of the sighting, the more likely to be unexplainable, just the opposite of what Carl said. Now, let's get to the heart of the matter. Is there any proof that government agencies are withholding information about flying saucers? The answer is yes. Without going through all the long history, and it's in my book, which I'm sold out of, but you can order by mail. This is a very exciting NSA top secret Umbra UFO document. You know the NSA, no such agency, never says anything, Mr. Snowden's outfit, you know. We used Freedom of Information back in the early 80s to go after the CIA. They published a list of documents they had about UFOs. Eventually they released 800 pages, only up through secret. But on the list that they gave out, which they couldn't release, we have to go to the NSA for theirs. We determined that even the document justifying withholding the NSA UFO documents, which was given to a federal court judge, who said the public interest in disclosure is far outweighed by the potential danger to the security of the United States if this information was released. That's what a federal court judge said. Well, time went by, we pushed some more. President Clinton signed a executive order saying that all classified stuff would have to be reviewed and most of it released. That's more than 20 years old. Again, a lot of shenanigans along the way. Everybody thought Clinton wasn't going to be reelected in 96. They didn't do anything. He did win reelection, so the Air Force is watching, examining 100,000 documents a month.
Okay.
Start the backup process. Oh. If I back up like this.
What the? Remind me
later.
I know it's. What the heck's going on here?
Print it.
Cancel it.
X. No such agency.
It's, I don't know what's going on.
Another
here.
X.
Dingy puck.
No.
I said cancel.
Cancel.
Well, you guys talk to each other. Let me talk to the audience here.
Hey. So Stan, this water for you too.
Good, thank you. Anyway, we eventually got 156 top secret Umbra NSA UFO documents. Like this. You can read one sentence per page. And I had people call me, believe it or not, say, Stan, they're not covering things up anymore. I said, can you read what's underneath the whiteout? Well, no, but then they are covering things up. 156. This is back in the 80s, mind you. Some people have tried to get the rest of the documents declassified. No such luck. Now, the CIA was a little bit different. Oh, that's another NSA document. Now, the CIA uses blacked out, and then recently they admitted that, well, that destroyed what was underneath, so they don't really have any uncleared, releasable documents. You can't read them anymore. It took me close to 3 years to get several dozen documents like this one. You can read, I think there are 8 words here up in the corner there. No, I think the NSA, well, I don't know who's, nobody tells me these things. I don't have a clearance anymore. Never did have for this kind of stuff. But what I'm trying to illustrate here, there are loads of pages that look just like this, which are totally uninformative, and I think which we can objectively say indicate a cover-up. If any of you knows a good lawyer who wants to get a lot of publicity, maybe he can go after these things. But it's a long battle. And just to illustrate the difficulties, many years ago, I filed a Freedom of Information Act request with the FBI and the CIA for my files. Told them where I was born, when I was born, my parents' names, you know, life history. And I mentioned that I'd had a security clearance for 14 years. And I know it was done by the FBI because I had friends call me and say, Stan, why is the FBI asking about you to get a clearance and a renewal and a renewal? Anyway, my first response was from the FBI. We don't have a file on you. Now, I know they did. And, you know, you can't say, well, we confused you with somebody else. How many Stanton Terry Friedmans are there in this planet? Then I heard from the CIA. And they sent me a little squib of paper. All we have on you is a negative name check request from the FBI. And there was a file number on that slip of paper, so I made a copy. I sent it back to the FBI and said, gentlemen, would you please recheck your files? Because according to this item I got from the CIA, you do have a file on me. Polite letter back. Yes, we do. We have rechecked our files, and we do have a file on you, but it's classified. So I sent a polite letter saying, I'd like to know the level of security on the file and the size of the file. Sorry, that information is classified too. You start out, we don't have a darn thing, and then we can't tell you anything, which is the whole point of the discussion, of course. That it's not that anything Lord knows what's in that file, I have no idea. There've been a lot of nasty things said about me by some nasty, noisy negativists, so maybe that's what's in there, I don't know. But these just illustrate the difficulty of getting at the facts, at the data. That's not openness. It took me 3 years, I guess. They're supposed to respond within 10 working days. You know, so they work 20 minutes a day. No, we won't say that. Another one. This was my favorite CIA document. Deny in toto. They couldn't find 8 lousy words to declassify. Okay, now, proof of cover-up. in early 1969, the University of Colorado completed its study on UFOs, Dr. Condon, and they recommended that Project Blue Book be closed because it wasn't really contributing anything to science or intelligence work and so forth. And I don't disagree with that. So they asked an Air Force General, Carol Bolander, what should we do about Project Blue Book? And he wrote a memo, which we didn't get until 10 years later when I think they mistakenly declassified it, for a guy named Bob Todd down in Philadelphia. And in this memo, he said some very interesting things. Moreover, reports of unidentified flying objects which could affect national security are made in accordance with JNAP, Joint Army Navy Air Force Publication 146, or Air Force Manual 55-11, and are not part of the Blue Book system. That's an incredible statement when the Air Force has been saying for loads of years, all we had going was Project Blue Book, and when they canceled it, there's no national security involvement, nothing to it. A lot of weasel-worded stuff that I've dissected in some of my books. Then two paragraphs later, however, as already stated, he was saying if we close Project Blue Book, the public won't have a place to report sightings. However, as already stated, reports of UFOs which could affect national security would continue to be handled through the standard Air Force procedures designed for this purpose. That's JNAP 146 or Air Force Manual 55-11. I located General Bolander, talked to him on the phone, and said, it sounds to me like you're saying there are two independent communication channels. That's right. I said, for example, if a saucer goes down the runway at a Strategic Air Command base, I just had a report like that at that time, that would, I presume, by definition, be a national security matter. Yes. But if my wife and I go off at the end of the driveway and see a flying saucer going by, that's standard channels. Yes, that's right. And if you look at the Air Force statements every year since 1969, they lie. No national security matter. As a matter of fact, kind of funny. Somebody found the regulations for military pilots, what they should do if they see an unidentified surface ship, an unidentified submarine, and unidentified flying objects. And it tells them who they should report to and what they should say and so forth. Lee Spiegel, a reporter for the Huffington Post, went after that, and suddenly that segment had been taken out of the regulation. They had goofed. They let something out in the open that anybody could see. So, the good men in blue and the Navy guys and anybody else who works for the military or the National Security Agency or anybody else, they handle national security matters involving flying saucers. The Air Force doesn't. Now remember, all the good equipment belongs to the government. I don't think many of you have your own personal radar installation. They're military airplanes with gun cameras on board to take pictures of flying saucers and with other pieces of equipment to monitor enemy, in quotes, aircraft near our borders and so forth. So we have a situation in which it's perfectly clear that it is standard policy not to report, investigate public sightings by the government, but to pay a lot of attention to those by people connected with the government, military guys. As a matter of fact, in 1952, orders were issued, shoot them down if they don't land when instructed to do so. You can think of a lot of cartoons that go with that, you know. And that was the policy. And I should add, between 51 and 56, 200 fatal military aircraft crashes. Even the New York Times using words like disappeared and disintegrated. And I have personally had 7 different people approach me after my lectures and very quietly tell me of being stationed at a base where a pilot had been scrambled to go after a jet, to go after a UFO. A jet had been scrambled to go after a UFO, and he never returned to base. And there's a book, By Any Means Necessary, for those of you who think, well, of course, the pilot's family would have been told what happened to him. Sorry. In By Any Means Necessary, they talk about the fate of 166 military airmen who were in planes that were tickling, their phrase, tickling the radar in Russia, Korea, and China, and got shot down. And their families were told absolutely nothing. Lost at sea, sorry about that. In 2001, they had a conference at which they brought in the families, gave them the medals that their sons or brothers or whatever had won, and told them what had happened to them, the best they know. That's a 50-year time lag. Do governments keep secrets? Yes. Even the stuff that isn't black is kept secret, that is, where we know its existence. There's Carol Bolander. A real person is what I'm saying. I'm not making this up. He's dead now, so you can't interview him. At least I don't know how to reach across that barrier. Now, let's give some practical, if that's the word, examples of large-scale cover-ups. Manhattan Project was set up to build the first atomic bomb. As part of that procedure, in secret, mind you, during World War II, we had to figure out a way to separate uranium isotopes so we could enrich what you got through this system in the U-235 isotope. Starts off at 0.7%, and you need about 80%, so that's a long way to go. So they built a facility, gaseous diffusion plant, in Oak Ridge, Tennessee. It was 1 mile long. You pump uranium hexafluoride gas through nickel barriers with tiny little holes, and more and more and more, and the lower atomic weight isotope goes through a little bit faster, and if you do this enough times, you wind up with highly enriched uranium. They were using 5% of the electrical power being produced in the United States to pump that gas through there, in secret. And it was in Oak Ridge, Tennessee, because of TVA, cheap power available. Bletchley Park, that was in England. 12,000 people worked there. Their job was to receive, decode, translate, and very carefully release German military communications. Very carefully, because if the Germans found out that we'd broken the code, and there's a movie out now, what's the name of it? Imitation, okay. I haven't seen it yet, it's on my list, but 12,000 people were doing this work, and it was extraordinarily important. It fooled Hitler into holding back the reserve troops when we invaded at Normandy, because he thought we were gonna, because of disinformation that was sent out, that we were going to attack at Calais, France, instead of at Normandy. And the general said, send in the reserve, and Hitler said, no. His inside information indicated, because they'd very cleverly disinformed him all over the place, that it was going to happen at Calais. Now, you'd think when the war was over that there would have been a lot of noise about how smart we were to break the codes. It told us where the Germans were sending their troops and so forth, and same with Japanese code. Not a word in public for 25 years. Were they just being stubborn? No, there were some people who were still using the German codes. We were reading their mail too. I don't know what it says in the movie, so, you know, I don't know if they went past that point. But 12,000 people didn't say boo for 25 years. Operation Solarium. When President Eisenhower came into office in early 1953, he wasn't happy with the direction we were moving in containment of the Soviet Union. And he set up three separate projects, teams, each one to look at one way of containment. And they made their reports, and that was responsible for American policy during the Cold War. Operation Solarium wasn't revealed until the mid-80s. It was very important that nobody know what it was we were planning to do, obviously. The U-2, you've heard of the U-2 spy plane, of course. Kind of interesting. The American people weren't told because the government knew it was violating the airspace of the Soviet Union, breaking international laws. We weren't going to say that. The Russians knew we were flying those planes over there. But they couldn't admit to their own people that they couldn't do anything about it, because the U-2 could fly higher than anybody else than their missiles at that time. And when finally one was shot down, Gary Powers, for those of you with long memories, at first we lied. I mean, I know it sounds difficult to believe that the government would lie, but it was just blown off course. The weather was bad. And I'll give Ike credit. When Khrushchev then showed the pictures of Gary Powers and his cameras and the downed aircraft, Ike admitted that we'd been spying. The world's too dangerous a place not for us not to know what's going on inside the Soviet Union. While that was going on, we knew that we'd have to do something else. We started on spy satellites. The Corona spy satellite had 12 failures in secret until the 13th one worked. And it got more data about military installations in the Soviet Union than all the U-2 flights that had preceded it. And we kept flying them. This wasn't in violation of international law, because upper space where satellites go is open territory, so to speak. And finally, we admitted it in the 90s. First successful flight in 61. And they had a neat way of getting the pictures back. They deorbited the film can from the satellite, and they caught it, like with a big fishnet, in airplanes going by at the right place at the right time. It sounds crude. It worked very well. But it's nice to know what your enemy is doing, and that they didn't have all kinds of missile installations all over the place. Kept secret from the American public and the rest of the world for, I mean, the Russians knew the satellites were up there, but. Stealth aircraft, Lockheed, $10 billion to build the first stealth, in secret. And 2 years ago, the Washington Post carried an article, black budget means doesn't show up in the congressional budget document. The Washington Post did some serious research, and they discovered that the total military intelligence budget that year was $52.6 billion, mostly CIA, NSA, and NRO, National Reconnaissance Office. In my mind, $52 billion is a lot of money. It was done in secret. There it is. August 29th, 0013. Well, I get a kick out of talking about classified propulsion technology because one of the major arguments against UFOs being alien spacecraft, any of them, you can't get here from there. When you start looking at these, they all fall apart, but the arguments are usually made by people with piled higher and deeper degrees who don't know what they're talking about. PhDs, real language. And there are still some people who, believe it or not, think that the only place research gets done is in academia. Well, I'm sorry to let you know that that isn't true. There are many places where research and development gets done. You may wonder what that monster is. There's a nuclear reactor inside that, which heats air that drives these jet engines down here. This is about 1956. It's on a railroad car because it becomes radioactive and you got to move it remotely back to your testing facility and stuff. Part of the ANP program, Aircraft Nuclear Propulsion Program. And when I worked on it in 1956 to 59, here's another model, early model. Here's what a flight system would look like. In 1958, our budget was $100 million. We employed 3,500 people, of whom 1,100 were engineers and scientists. This wasn't a black program, but nobody made a lot of noise about it. And to my mind anyway, $100 million is quite a lot of money in 1958. Today, well, still a lot of money. Here's a nuclear ramjet. The advantage of a nuclear airplane, in case you're wondering, is that you could fly for thousands of hours without refueling. You replace the crew. So you've got unlimited range. This is a nuclear ramjet, early 60s. The idea in this, you'd carry it aloft on a B-52, under a B-52, whatever, and you could drop a nuclear weapon on any point on Earth. So if it's military, we'll spend the dough, so we can go. That program was canceled too. Nuclear rocket engines, now we're talking. This is a layout of what it would look like. Very cold liquid hydrogen comes in, gets heated in the reactor, and it exits at over 4,000 degrees. And you're thinking, well, that's interesting science fiction, but no. I worked on this one, Westinghouse Astronuclear Lab. The reactor's inside there, about this big. Power level was only 1,100 megawatts. That's half the power of Hoover Dam, this big. That was Westinghouse. Here's the Aerojet General one, more flight type, only 1,000 megawatts. Los Alamos built the Phoebus, a little bit larger. Power level was 4,400 megawatts, twice the power of Hoover Dam in something this big. Then the program was canceled, because nobody had guts enough to say, we want to go, give us the dough. But it worked. Out at the nuclear test site, not far from Area 51, I better add. That's one of them. These are tanks of liquid hydrogen. When we started, I worked on this program. When we started, nobody can use liquid hydrogen. It's too dangerous. I'm reminded that there were cities who said you couldn't store gasoline for the newfangled automobiles because it was too dangerous. We get over it. And Area 51 is over the other side of those mountains, but we don't know where that is, so don't worry about it. This is a nuclear test site in Nevada. Spent a lot of money, a lot of people. It was exciting work until they canceled the darn program. Now, the real Jim Dandy, nuclear fusion. We have joined the ranks of the advanced societies, not very, but advanced, who finally figured out that almost all the energy in the universe is created by nuclear fusion. Those systems I was talking about were fission systems. The Navy uses fission-powered reactors for submarines and aircraft carriers. Nuclear fusion is what goes on in the sun and all the other billions and billions of stars. What's the advantage of nuclear fusion? A heck of a lot more bang per pound. These don't let the symbols fool you. This is helium-3 and heavy hydrogen, deuterium. And here's the important thing. Every reaction gives you 18.3 MeV, million electron volts. When you light a match, other chemical reactions, you're talking about under 20 electron volts. This is 18 million electron. And you can see, we know about this because we figured out in the late 30s that fusion is what goes on in the stars. And just to take the progression, in 1944, a big bomb was a 10-ton blockbuster. That's 10 tons of dynamite. That's how much energy was released, as if you were exploding 10 tons of dynamite. Make a pretty big hole in the ground. Took a big B-29 to carry it. Well, 1945, July 16th, tested our first atomic bomb. And we eventually delivered it on others on Japan with a big B-29. Amount of energy released? 15,000 tons of dynamite. We're getting there. 1952, our first hydrogen bomb, which is a fusion device. Release the energy of 10 million tons of TNT. From 44 to 52, 8 years. From a 10-ton bomb to one releasing 10 million tons of dynamite energy, if you will. The Russians tested one a little larger, 50 million tons of TNT. Even our first one had a fireball diameter of 3 miles. So we're not talking in the same ball game, in other words, when you go from a 10-ton bomb to a 15,000-ton to 50 million. I worked on a study of nuclear fusion for deep space propulsion back in 1962, directed by the man who headed the fusion research at Oak Ridge National Laboratory, Dr. John Luce. I say doctor, that was an honorary degree. John had a high school diploma, 40 patents, gave papers all over the world. Brilliant man, always doing things that the PhD said couldn't be done in plasma physics work. So the idea of using fusion propulsion is not a new one. As a matter of fact, you could kick particles out the back end of a rocket that have 10 million times as much energy per particle as they can get in a dumb old chemical rocket. So when somebody says, is it possible to get here from there? The answer is it depends. What materials you use, what methodology you use, what your flight profile is. There was a guy who published, an astronomer who published an article in 1941 showing that the required initial launch weight of a rocket to get a man to the moon and back would be a million, million tons. Saturn V weighed 3,000 tons. He made every possible stupid assumption. Limit of 1G, and you got to provide all the energy. He didn't know about cosmic freeloading. You know, all our deep space probes take advantage of the gravitational field of, well, all different bodies out there. We've got a body out at Saturn, Cassini spacecraft. We sent it closer to the sun to go past Venus to get a free kick. Came back past Earth, got another free kick. went out past Jupiter and got another free kick and wound up near Saturn. When we go to the moon, we use the moon's gravitational field. It's there, it's free, be in the right place at the right time. That's why they launch windows, taking advantage of Mother Nature. Everything depends on the details. The devil's in the details. But I'm not saying there isn't something better than fusion. I'm saying it's a heck of a lot better than anything we're using and will get us to the stars. Somebody's got to decide they want to go, of course, which is a different question. And you want to spend the money. These things cost lots of money. Three-mile-wide fireball in that first H-bomb. And it wasn't tested in the United States, of course. It was tested on a little island in the Pacific. Beat the heck out of the island, I must say. And people wonder, well, why don't the aliens come and land on a White House lawn? We're nice guys here, aren't we? No, we're not. We killed 50 million people during World War II. We destroyed 1,700 cities. We have exploded 2,000 nuclear warheads. Only two on Japan, thank goodness. 2,000. Nobody can say we're a nice, polite, freedom-loving, open society that would welcome aliens with open arms. I don't think so. Now let's look at the nuclear navy for a minute. This is a nuclear-powered submarine. A lot of people heard a lot about submarines during World War II. They could stay underwater for a day. You need air for the diesel engines. Now, people need some to breathe, too, but that's easier to handle than the amount you need for the engines. Okay. Admiral Rickover got in the act. We have nuclear submarines that can go around the world underwater. They take periscope leave when they go past Hawaii. That's what one of the Navy guys told me. He looked through the periscope, hey, there's land up there. That was in 56 was the first one, incidentally. But then we did something that's directly relevant here. That's a nuclear-powered aircraft carrier. You can tell from E equals MC squared. Now, what's special about nuclear-powered aircraft carriers is not only that they're big, they can carry a whole bunch of little airplanes. They can operate for 18 years without refueling. No gas stations out there, and it means you can go full speed ahead day after day after day after day, which you could never do with a conventional carrier. But here's the analogy that I want you to understand. If we talk about going from the stars, people say, Stan, how could you believe in Roswell? Surely an advanced civilization coming here from another star system wouldn't crash. I say, well, what crashed wasn't coming from another star system directly. We have lots of reports of huge motherships. By huge, I mean half mile to a mile long, which is pretty good size. And just like this aircraft carrier, the airplanes can operate for what, 2 hours without refueling? They don't work worth a darn on the water. The carrier doesn't fly worth a darn, but 18 years. So you use the big mothership from star A to here, and the little Earth excursion modules operating in an entirely different environment, atmosphere, temperature, pressure, all that sort of, gravity field, all that sort of stuff. So it's a good analogy. The nice thing about the submarines, incidentally, is you can be ready to retaliate mutual assured destruction. Somebody drops a bomb in the United States, they can set off one of the submarines to launch one from under the water. The Russians don't know where they are. So you get me, but I'll get you, buddy. Nuclear powered. And we're not, the United States isn't the only country that has these. But that's an incredible monster, if you will, when you stop to think about it. Okay, now we get to Majestic 12. Top secret document. Got to tell you the story. End of 1984, a colleague of mine, Jamie Chandray, working with Bill Moore, with whom I had worked very closely on the Roswell incident, receives a roll of film in the mail. No return address, postmarked Albuquerque. There are two sets of eight negatives each of a top secret document, top secret magic. This is related to that. It wasn't on the roll of film. But it mentions MJ-12, Majestic 12, Magic 12, call it what you want. And according to a briefing for President Eisenhower, dated 1952, he was President-elect Eisenhower at the time, President Truman signed up for Operation Majestic 12 because of Roswell. And named the members of a group of 12 who would be responsible for collecting, evaluating, et cetera, all kinds of information about flying saucers. Mentioned that there has been a crash at Roswell, that bodies were recovered. And the question, of course, is whether, is this document genuine? It's on film, so you can't test paper directly. Spent an awful lot of time, written a book and articles and so forth. I'm convinced that there's about 100 documents around that purport to be related to MJ-12. And I think almost all of them are frauds. When good stuff gets out, you flood the market with garbage. Standard practice in the intelligence field. And I've looked at all the anti-arguments. None of them stand up. This one's important because one of the biggest, the nastiest, noisiest negativist was a guy named Philip Klass, wrote for Aviation Week and Space Technology. And he said this document is obviously a fraud because of the pica type. Standard at the White House was elite type, and he had 9 documents to prove it. And he challenged me to find any other genuine documents meeting a whole bunch of criteria done in the same size and style pica type. And he would pay me $100 each up to a maximum of 10. Now, as it turns out, I've double-checked this, he'd never been to the Eisenhower Library. That's the time frame we're talking about for these documents. And I was going there anyway, so I went to my files and found plenty of pica type documents. They didn't meet all his criteria except for 2 of them. And he thought he had me. Well, I was going to the Eisenhower Library, so I went. It's easy to spot the difference between pica and elite, for those of you who remember what typewriters are. And I dug out 14, copied them, sent him a copy, and he set a limit of 10, unfortunately, so I sent him an invoice for $1,000. And he paid me. Oh. Well, oh yes, this is relevant. I wanted to show you a copy of his check. I don't know if it's here. This gentleman worked in Truman's office, George Elsie, the whole time Truman was in the White House. And I had asked the Truman Library if they knew anybody who was still around from the time when those documents were supposedly dated from. They mentioned Elsie. I located him. I said, I'd like to send you some documents and get your opinion if I could. Sure. So I sent it to him, and just before I called him up, I said I'd call in a few weeks, and I suddenly realized if he knew anything, he couldn't tell me. So I had to ask my questions, not are the documents genuine? Did you see anything about the documents that would lead you to believe they were phony? He could answer that, you see. And there's a list of these 12 members, which I'll show you in a minute. Do you have any reason to think that Truman, if such an event as Roswell had happened, would not have picked one of these guys because he couldn't stand them or anything like that? And so I asked a whole bunch of questions, and about that letter, that memo I just showed you, it was had the author being a guy named Robert Cutler, who was Ike's national security advisor. We found out later Cutler was out of the country. So it's a good thing there wasn't a signature on it. If there'd been a signature, it would have been fraudulent. And he told me that Cutler sat next to James Lay, who was the executive secretary of the National Security Council. And of course he would have sent a memo in Cutler's place. He told me all kinds of other stuff, but it was very useful to talk to somebody who was there at the time, who knew the people involved. And I was glad to get that opinion from him. He's written a book, An Unplanned Life. He was a young Navy guy. Incidentally, about keeping secrets, Truman's advisor on explosives, when he heard about the atomic bomb program, which Truman didn't know about while he was a senator and didn't know about when he became vice president, he was only told 13 days after Roosevelt died, and Truman had to make the decision as to whether or not to drop the atomic bomb. His explosives expert told him, I'm an expert on explosives, and boy, this is crazy. That thing's not going to work at all. He was wrong. He didn't know anything about nuclear explosions as opposed to chemical explosions. Here's the authorization from Truman. Oh, that signature's a fake. It looks too much like other Truman signatures. Truman wrote to his sister after he was elected in 48. Remember, Dewey defeats Truman, that election, you know? he wrote over 500 thank you notes to people for their assistance during the campaign. And I can't believe that there were no two alike. And even experts on signatures say you can have identical signatures, just not consecutive. You know, your hand moves and so forth and so on. Anyway, this is the briefing document that was the main part of that. Warning, this is a top secret eyes only document containing compartmentalized information essential to the national security of the United States. Eyes only access to the material are in is strictly limited to those possessing Majestic 12 clearance. Dated in November 1952. A briefing for President-elect Eisenhower. This lists the people. You'll see a larger size. Some of you will recognize some of the names here, maybe. General Vandenberg, General Twining, James Forrestal, Secretary of Defense. There was one surprise, real surprise. All these guys had high-level security clearances, but as far as we knew, except for Dr. Donald Menzel. Some are scientists, some are military. Menzel was a total debunker. Wrote 3 anti-UFO books, gave papers, wrote articles. It's all malarkey. How could he be a part of a team that knew about a crashed saucer, alien bodies, and so forth? Impossible. Well, I was very dubious about Menzel. I found his name, though, in some correspondence with Dr. Bush, who was also named in this thing. Make a long story short, I had to get permission from 3 different people. I went to Harvard to look at his papers. These guys were all dead. How convenient, you might say. permission from 3 different people to see Menzel's papers. And I knew that his UFO correspondence was at the American Philosophical Society Library. Where should I look? Well, there was an item that said JFK. Okay. Was totally shocked. There was correspondence between Menzel and JFK. JFK was on the board of overseers at Harvard. And his area of interest was astronomy, and Menzel was his contact there. Menzel was a professor, chairman of the department at Harvard. But that's not what was interesting. There's a letter from Menzel to JFK saying, there's one area where I may be of assistance in the 1960 campaign as when he got elected. That's with regard to the NSA. I've got a longer continuous association with them of anybody in the country. 30 years with them and the Navy predecessor. When we are properly cleared to each other, I can tell you more. It turns out he was a world-class cryptographer. That's what the NSA is into, decoding stuff and all that sort of thing. He set up 7 different places where women were being taught how to be cryptographers at the beginning of the Second World War. Why women, so the men were going off to war and would try to get in the program just to get out of going off to war. These are at the women's colleges around Harvard, where Menzel was. Turned out, there's even a big paper which I got from 3 years back, Donald Menzel's contributions to cryptology. And they were considerable. And none of this shows up. He was head of the Navy Reserve Unit at Cambridge, Massachusetts. There's a whole long bunch of stuff that's in one of my books, The Secret Life of Donald Menzel. I was totally shocked. I didn't like the man when he was alive. We had a run-in when I spoke at Harvard. And I was bowled over. And I've had people complain about my saying he couldn't have let a double life stand. He was a debunker. Well, the 3 names, Burgess, McLean, and Philby, were some of you recognize them, huh? Russian spies working in British intelligence. That's leading a double life, because you got to be very careful that nobody can trace something back to you and so forth. But that encouraged me to go on about MJ-12. I believe the documents 3 are real. There's Menzel. I developed a heck of a lot of respect for this man. I didn't like him beforehand, but it's a long story. It's an interesting story. Somebody wants to do an interesting biography, Menzel would be a good guy. Now there's Mr. Class, who's the one who challenged me on the typeface and a whole bunch of other things which he got wrong. There's his check to me. He paid, but it's interesting. His papers are at the American Philosophical Society Library. There is no Friedman file. We corresponded for 20 years. I wonder why. I don't think he wanted anybody to know about paying me that $1,000. I pointed out other mistakes that he'd made in the letters too, so could have had something to do with it. There are all kinds of claims being made. I'll just, the debunkers pick up on anything. The date format in the document was wrong, the briefing document. Violates the government style manual. I found many different date formats. Including one file folder, incidentally, that had 7 different date formats in it. And I found documents done by the briefing officer, Admiral Hillencoder, using the same date format. In typewriter days, it depends on who typed things. Somebody said, well, that thing said top secret restricted. We have a statement from the government saying it was never used before Nixon's administration. Well, the General Accounting Office was asked to look for Roswell data, and in the course of publishing a 400-page report, page 82, I think it was, they noted that they were at a certain facility. They didn't find anything about Roswell. However, we noted several examples of the use of top secret restricted, even though we had been told, Majestic 12, that it was not in use at that time. I try to get copies of those documents. They're still classified, Stan. You can't get copies of those, but that they said that is good enough for me. It refers to Admiral Hillencoder, but he was only a rear admiral. Obviously, the document's fraudulent. We start looking around, and they use generic ranks for all of the military guys. It was standard practice. I asked 2 different archivists at the Eisenhower Library, does it bother you that they use generic ranks? No, it's standard practice. Ike used them in his book when he talked about certain military officers. You check and you find out they weren't 4 stars. but he called him general. All top secret documents must have top secret control numbers, I was told very adamantly. Again, the archivist said, we got loads of stuff top secret that doesn't have control numbers on it. About the signature from Cutler. Two different typefaces on the same document. Obviously, it's a fraud. George Elsie told me that it often happened. Certain documents, you don't put a date on it, the numerical part of the date, until the right day, because you need an official record on that. And so you put it back in the typewriter when you finally get the right day. And I found several other documents that had Elite and Pike on the same page. Nothing wrong with that. Oh, here's something Menzel said. All non-explained sightings are from poor observers. I showed you the data that said the better the quality, the more likely to be unexplained. Oh, somebody said there was no NSC meeting on that date that you were looking at. It didn't say NSC meeting, it said meeting, it said an already scheduled meeting. So you gotta go through this stuff, nitpick by nitpick. And somebody complained, well, Friedman didn't find any evidence in Menzel's papers that nothing mentioned MJ-12. Here's a guy who's had a top secret clearance for umpteen years, and he's gonna leave highly classified stuff around? I had other people tell me, oh, all those guys would have told their wives what they were doing. Malarkey. I never told my wife anything classified. Loose lips sink ships. You just don't do it. As a matter of fact, General Groves headed the atomic bomb program, the Manhattan Project. The first time his wife found out what he'd been doing for the previous 2 years was somebody from his office called her and thought she ought to listen to the news at noon. It was August 6th, 1945, and he announced that the first atomic bomb had been dropped on Japan. And she thought the officer had called her because their son was expecting to be shipped over to fight in the Pacific War. The last sentence of the program was, the program to develop these incredible atomic bombs was under the direction of General Leslie Groves. That's when she found out what her husband had been doing for the previous 2 years. You don't pass classified data on casually. And I'm sure there's some people here who've had security clearances in Canada or the United States, and you'll know what I'm talking about. Oh, they said Cutler's papers are all on a certain kind of carbon paper. You all remember what carbon paper is, I hope. And when I was at the library, I showed several different watermark papers. I saw you a copy of my book, but I'm out. You gotta use the order blank that's out there. You can get the Travis Walton film, unless he's gonna sell some here. Where'd he go? Chris, you gonna sell any Travis Walton movies? I guess not. Oh, there's a good book. Not just because I wrote the foreword, but the FBI-CIA UFO connection. Dr. Bruce McAbee worked at a Navy research lab for over 30 years. He got the first release of FBI UFO documents, well over 1,000 pages. Nobody knew they had any. He hit it lucky, got the right guy on the other end on freedom of information. Oh, can't keep secrets? That's jumbo. We were gonna test our first atomic bomb in that. So if it didn't work, we wouldn't lose the plutonium on which we'd spent so much effort developing. Wiser heads prevailed. They hung it alongside and it survived, sort of. If you go to Trinity site, you can see it sitting off on the side there. But they moved it from Ohio to New Mexico in secret. And certainly didn't have anybody know what it was for. Oh, I made up a list of about a dozen facts which weren't previously known, but which turned out to be true. And how did a hoaxer know those is what I want to know. We didn't know that Cutler was out of the country on that certain date. How come the date of the Truman letter to Forrestal is the only day in an 8-month period where those two met with Van Bush, who's also mentioned in the item? How did anybody know that? Coincidence? All kinds of little trivial details. This is to let you know that there is this kind of information for those of you who wonder about these documents. Here's a book by Jesse Marcel Jr., who was an otolaryngologist, I think that's how you say that. Colonel was called back into the military and flew 225 combat hours in the Middle East, because he was also a pilot, flying helicopters. He was called back in at age 68. He was a patriot. He died 2 years ago. Oh, I love the explanation, crash test dummies. The dummy's the one in the middle, incidentally. I talked to this man. He was in charge of the program. A couple of key facts. The dummies were made out of wood, of course. None were dropped until 6 years after Roswell. So we got time travel for crash test dummies. That's an easy explanation, you know. And you notice that he's in Air Force gear. They use these to try to come up with a good ejection seat for a plane moving at 40,000 feet altitude and flying at very high speed. And when you eject, should you open your parachute right away, or will you freeze to death? Or, you know, you don't use real pilots for this until you get it perfected. But nobody, you can understand all the ranchers in New Mexico would immediately think when they saw that there's been an alien invasion. How absurd. I met with Colonel Madsen. I don't know of anybody else who did. Definitive study of the Roswell incident. I'm the original civilian investigator. Here's about MJ Majestic 12, top secret magic. And I don't know what that picture is. The publisher put it on without my knowledge. And what's that? Well, I don't know, Sam. It's a good looking UFO picture. Yeah, but you want me to stand behind it? There's a few of the books that you can't see out there because they're all sold. Oh, and I gotta give you a little cartoon. It's always nice to be recognized by your peers. That was on a New Brunswick newspaper. The clock says 3:30. I didn't get back my 7 minutes, but that's okay. I'll try to answer questions. Thank you. Any questions? Are you handling that? Or
I'm going to handle that. I'll just grab the mic here.
Oh, that helps.
Can you hear me? Oh, there we go. All right. So just so we make this easy, how about first five people to make it to the front of stage, you can ask your question. Let's just do it like that. Come on up. Let's do it. We got about 10, 15 minutes here, and then it's a race.
No, don't break your leg.
Okay, well, how about this? Just someone is asking a question for the first time. We'll start and we'll go here. There you go, sir.
I was interested in your comments about Donald Menzel.
Yes.
And there have also been questions raised about Carl Sagan and the possibility that he had a two-faced role. Do you have any opinion about that?
Well, I met with Carl a year before he died. As I said, we were classmates, and I was speaking at Cornell, so the guy in charge of the program brought me to his house after the airport, and we had coffee and cake and so forth. And it was a friendly conversation. We'd been in the same class for 3 years. And I think there's a possibility that he was on a committee that had a secret clearance. They're the ones who recommended the Condon study, incidentally. But Carl also was involved in demonstrations against the government about nuclear weapons and all that sort of stuff. And my personal feeling, and that's all I can call it, because the Library of Congress has just received 1,700 boxes of Sagan files. And I've got the finder's aid. They've had them for less than a year. I haven't been there yet. So, and there are a couple of boxes of classified materials.
Are you asking?
I might find out.
No.
I think not. Now, there is a Nobel Prize winner whose name suddenly escapes me, physics from Harvard, who was on Ike's scientific advisory board, and his son let me look at his papers. He's dead, but, and I don't know why, but I know he's a guy who did high-level classified work, and the Eisenhower Library assures me that he had a top-secret clearance when he was on the scientific advisory board.
This is,
when NACA became NASA.
I think he's kind of wrapping it in. It was a very important subject.
And so I'll be trying to find out more about that. But, you know, you have your suspicions, but that suspicion isn't enough.
Thank you.
I'm just kind of wondering what the Canadian connection is here. We talk about the world stage.
Well, you're an Earthling, aren't you?
Yes. Last time I checked.
The Canadian connection is only that, surprisingly, when I have a friend, John Greenwald, who has the Black Vault, which has zillions of formerly classified documents on it, when he was looking for some of those reports from JNAP 146, that's a joint American-Canadian enterprise.
So has any of the testing, the atomic testing that we did, anything that was hidden that was done in Canada as well?
Not
that you know of.
No, but what I'm getting at is that
push for disclosure for the United States. What about the rest of the world? Like, we've already done
it depends on where you go. The governments in South America, several of them have, there are military people working with UFO groups in Brazil, in Chile, in Peru, Denmark, and there are a couple of other countries like that. So remember, though, that the U.S. was the obvious target if aliens were going to be checking around. Atomic bombs, rockets. You know, people forget New Mexico, Roswell is in New Mexico. It was the only place in the world at that time where you could check on rockets and on atomic bombs. The captured German missiles went to New Mexico, White Sands Missile Range and stuff. So it's a logical place to start. We didn't have, 1,700 cities got destroyed during World War II. None of them were in the United States or Canada. And so Canada's a less important player because we didn't make atomic bombs. I didn't say we never had any here. That's a different question. You know, stationed
here. It's definitely a connection, though.
Well, sure, but I'm saying if you're looking for atomic bombs, the States were the place to go because you could measure the radioactivity in the air from the testing that had been done, you see. So that's a no-brainer. You know these idiots are doing it, and the Russians didn't have their first one until 1949.
I just find it really interesting that the whole world stage is asking the United States to disclose. All the world is doing it.
Well, I'm much more aware that there's plenty of stuff going on in the Soviet Union, for example. We have clear indications there have been some statements made over there. How valid they are, I don't know. But one of them was that Medvedev, who's the, I want to say president, that's the wrong title. He's not chief of staff either, and he's not the prime, maybe he's a prime minister, I don't know.
Yeah,
prime minister. That he was asked by a reporter whether presidents, whether prime ministers get briefed on UFOs when they get briefed on the controls for setting off atomic bombs. You know, they got to carry stuff with them all the time, ready to go, and codes and all that sort of stuff. And supposedly he said yes, that they were briefed on UFO stuff. I don't know how true that statement is. I don't believe anything because I find there's so many liars out there, hoaxers. Yeah, well, it's just hard, unless you do your due diligence, which I like to do when I get the chance, and I'm anxious to get at Carl's papers. But I don't live near Washington, D.C., and you gotta, you know. So I'll get there.
Thank you.
Okay.
Hi, Stan.
Hi.
As you know, I run an historical UFO website up in Sudbury. And the one question or the one bit of information we seem like my friends and I argue about is because of all the money that's been dumped in back engineering, how far along
do you Well, how do we know that?
Well, we're hoping. I guess we're thinking that the back engineering, the money that's being funneled into UFOs is to try to find out how the technology works and how, to what extent we'd actually use it for whichever group that's in the hub that's actually controlling all this stuff in the secrecy. How far do you think? My friends tend to think that we've got fleets of UFOs that we somehow in less than 60 years have come up and developed, which I don't think is even remotely possible because we're talking about technology. I've seen UFOs. And the technology seems to be at least, if not hundreds of thousands of years old, at least possibly millions of years old. And for us little hairless monkeys to have come up with a similar technology, even with money being dumped into it, what is your gut instinct telling you how far along we've come with the back engineering? Or is the military frustrated because the aliens are not stupid enough to give us little hairless monkey that much advanced technology because they know what we do with it?
Well, that's a multifaceted question. I would say this, that I don't think we've succeeded. I think we've learned bits and pieces here and there. For example, there's a picture in Flying Saucers and Science of me with my hand on the Apollo 12 command module. I gave a talk to NASA people. They took me on a tour, took my picture, and nice picture. And when I was growing up, everybody thought a high-speed craft in the atmosphere had to have a pointy nose, sharp wings, highly streamlined, like the X-1 that broke the sound barrier and stuff. And this thing comes in at 25,000 miles an hour. It's a big, fat, round, blunt body, just like a UFO. It turns out they did some wind tunnel testing in the 40s of round, blunt bodies. You don't think we'd build one like that unless we knew that it was going to work. So I think we may have gotten the idea from observations from people. Another sort of esoteric example, what I would do if I were in charge, which I wasn't, was send out the wreckage from Roswell, pieces of it, it's all over the place, to a bunch of classified labs, not some universities, people who had clearances and talent, and we knew where they were because of the Manhattan Project, and say, what is this stuff? And the guy comes back to you and says, gee, I don't know where you got this. You wouldn't tell him. He didn't have a need to know for that. It's a combination of samarium and cobalt. Why the heck would anybody put those two together? Not your problem. You send it out to other people, measure the magnetic, thermal, electric properties of this stuff. A guy comes back and says, you know, I don't know what this stuff is or where you got it, but highest magnetic moment I've ever measured for a material, make a great permanent magnet. And pretty soon we were building ghetto blasters with samarium cobalt permanent magnets. Well, I used to use that as an example. You haven't learned how to build a craft, but you've learned something useful. Then I did a weekly science commentary in Fredericton for CBC for 6 years, and I'm reading an article about new and better permanent magnets, neodymium boron iron. I'm not making them up. And at the end of the article, it said the original work on samarium cobalt was done at Wright Air Development Center, which is at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, and I just laughed. I'll bet I know where that idea came from. Without acknowledgement, you understand. And so I think the reason we've had a lot of technological progress is we spent a lot of money. You put enough money, you're going to learn some things. On the other hand, if I thought we were able to duplicate flying saucer capabilities, or that the Nazis were, that's another popular story, they would have used it, and so would we. We built the stealth aircraft, we used it. If we had that capability, why would we be having the Cold War now? We can fly circles, we'd be able to fly circles around anybody out there. So I don't think our back engineering has produced a fleet of anything. And I hate to say this, but I think stories about our having gone to Mars and been based there for 17 years or whatever. And if the air is breathable and so forth, I don't believe them. Let me put it the other way. I haven't seen any evidence that they're true. I can't prove that they're false, but I haven't seen any evidence that they're true.
Yeah, it's hard to come by. It would be kind of, because I've gotten reports, when we used to have a radar base up north, one of my friends actually worked for INCO, which was one of the mining giants that we had up there. And in the 60s, late 60s, a UFO was tracked on radar traveling at 22,000 miles an hour from 15 miles while it was hovering over the property. And it angled up at 45 degree angle. And they all witnessed this, top welders and plate shop workers. And something that fast would literally crush us against the windshield.
But well, it's acceleration that crushes you against the windshield, but not velocity.
But it's still fascinating. If we were to come up with something like that, I mean, the possibilities are limitless.
It'd be good business for Canada to build a bunch of these, wouldn't it? Like the Avro car, except it didn't have what it takes.
No, please.
This is really quick, and you were alluding to it already. I was just wondering what your take is on the stories about Eisenhower having met with the aliens in a face-to-face sit-down at the Air Force Base in 54.
Holloman Air Force Base.
Yes.
There's a guy named Art Campbell, lives in Oregon, who has talked to members of Ike's presidential plane crew. And he's come up with a book and very interesting story that Ike was supposedly playing golf in Georgia. He did a lot of that. And that they secretly went off to Holloman and the UFO was down the end of the runway and they were over on this side and that they got together. I can't prove that that's true, but I've met with Art and I'm very impressed with the work he's done. And he got more than one person. You have to approach people carefully, let them do the talking. You don't put words in their mouth and then say, is that true? That won't do it. Yeah. I had to be very careful when talking to Elsie about my suggestions. Let it come from him, you know. I would allow for that possibility, seriously. How I can prove it at this point, Art may get, when the book gets widely distributed, may get other people coming forward. But remember, if there was one president who proved that he could keep secrets, Ike's the guy. And I, you know, a lot of people don't think much of Eisenhower, the lightweight, some people called him. But can you imagine having to do the job he did in the late 40s, early 50s, before he was elected, to get the Germans to join with the United States, the British and the French and the Canadians, to fight against the Russians. We just fought a war with the Germans, second war. Yeah. Now that took a man with talent in human relations and in knowing about secrets. You know, Ike himself passed on every, he gave the final approval on every U-2 flight. You know, what are the objectives, what are the positive, negative, and so forth. So I have enormous respect for him as somebody who cared about the planet. He warned about the military-industrial complex, you remember, and there were some other lines in there about be careful, which we don't hear about, but which are interesting. So I'd say better than a 60% chance is true. How's that?
That's
fine. Where's my dartboard?
Last question. You mentioned the Nazis. And the, you know, there's a gazillion stories. The event in 46 and 47 with Admiral Byrd from the U.S. Navy going to the
Antarctica.
And that whole story.
I've got very mixed feelings about it. I'm wary of Byrd stories because, that sounds funny, but there was somebody claiming to be his nephew, who had all kinds of stories about Byrd going at the North Pole underground to the secret society underground there and stuff like that. Yeah. And when I did some checking with the Byrd family, they're a powerful family in the United States, Senator Byrd and so forth. They're not nobodies. And I talked to somebody who worked with the family for years, and He wasn't even an he wasn't related to them. He wasn't even an FPU. The whole story was made up. So I'm not saying it didn't happen.
But I mean, he went up with 5,000 troops, like an entire division, and they lost a battleship, and they had a whole bunch of people killed, and it's in the Antarctic, and there's supposed to be nobody there. So
It's in my gray basket. Let me put it that way. A story like that needs an awful lot of work before you should say yay or nay. It may sound good.
No, it's a crazy story.
Okay.
All right, well, let's hear for Stan Friedman, guys, one more time. Thank you so much.